in this tribunal with an international organizing committee meeting each 2 months in Paris. And this organizing committee have decided to have the 4 sessions that we have till now. The first one in Barcelona, the second one in London, the third one in Cape Town in South Africa, and this 4th one here in New York. After this 4th session, we will have a last session in Brussels, where we will, with all the members of the jury, make the global conclusion of the Russell Tribunal on Palestine, and from there, we will assume the distribution of all this conclusion all over the world. Human rights, international law, humanitarian law must be respected essentially today for the Palestinian people, but also all over the world. To do our job, we have a very nice jury. You can see around the table here the 11 members of the jury, and they will make their duty to be sure that we can reach the conclusion that we need to denounce the complicity of the American state of America in their support to the occupation by Israel, the occupation of Palestine, the colonization, and all these different aspects of the violation of the international law. That's the Human Declaration of Human Rights. And we have with us today the only survivor of the people having built this Human Rights Declaration. It's our chair of the jury, Stefan Essel. Please, Stefan.
Citizens, male and female, it is a very special session. We are meeting at a time when the General Assembly of the United Nations is meeting in this city and is able to try to bring forward a better knowledge everywhere of the basic human principles and international law. On the question of Palestine, it is not necessary to dwell. You all know how this unfortunate population has been abused and over-abused for the past 60 years, and with nobody to really be there to help it achieve at last the statehood that it deserves. What we want to do here today and tomorrow and the day after is to make clear that not only the government of the United States, but the United Nations as a whole has not been able to do more than to draft resolutions, to say what should be done, and to do nothing that it can actually be done. We want to put a new impulse on the media particularly, and on all of you, each one of you, you can all help, so that this impossible situation and that this impunity that is reached to Israel, not only by the United Nations, but by the United States, should find an end. If we achieve some progress in that, thanks to your being there listening to us, then the day will have been worth living. Thank you.
So without any further ado, we would like here with Miguel Angel Estrella to call on Ilan Pappe, who will address the tribunal on the topic, the birth of Zionism and its impact on the Palestinians.
It's very difficult to condense a historical analysis and transform it into an evidence. But I will try to do that by focusing on 5 bullet points. The first point is about the impact of early Zionism on Palestine. As you probably know, Zionism began as a noble movement that had two impulses that one can understand. The impulse to find security for Jews in Central and Eastern Europe, and a wish to redefine Judaism as nationalism, as so many other religious and cultural groups did in the mid of the 19th century. The problem with that noble movement was when it decided that the only territory where it can implement these two impulses was a land already inhabited by other people. So I think the first point, and a very important point, is to understand that Palestine was a thriving place, a thriving society when Zionism entered the land. The second point I would like to make is about the basic attitudes of early Zionists towards the native indigenous population of Palestine. Now, these first impressions were that the Palestinians were foreign aliens present in a country that waited to be redeemed by the Jewish people. These very people were usurpers, were aliens who overtook or took over something that belonged to the Jewish people 2,000 years ago. The idea of an alien native is very peculiar to the Zionist movement and is at the heart of the Zionist and Israeli policies towards the Palestinians. The third point I would like to make is that Zionism in the mandatory period between 1918 and 1948 had failed in two respects. Demographically, it failed because the basic impulse of Zionism was to create a democratic society, but at the same time, a Jewish society. Hence, in order for the democracy to be valid, what you needed was a solid or even exclusive Jewish majority. In order to get a Jewish majority, you needed to bring as many Jews as you could to Palestine and to find ways of getting rid of the Palestinians on the other hand. When the British have left Palestine in 1948, only one third of the population were Jews in Palestine. That was one failure from a Zionist perspective. The second failure was geographical. The Zionist movement tried to buy and purchase land to create a Jewish state. By the end of the British mandate, it succeeded in buying only 7% of the land of Palestine. The inevitable result of these two failures was the decision in February 1947 by the Zionist movement to ethnically cleanse Palestine. And as we are within a framework of a tribunal which has a legal orientation, let me remind the ladies and gentlemen of the tribunal that ethnic cleansing is a crime against humanity. It's a crime against humanity that only genocide is above it. The idea to dispossess Palestine, to de-Arabize Palestine, was there from the 1930s and was implemented long before it was clear what would be the Palestinian position on partition or what would be the United Nations ideas of peace. Secondly, even the argument that saying that if the Palestinian leadership rejected partition, which is understandable, it cannot be punished by the destruction of half of Palestine's villages, by the destruction of half of Palestine's cities, and by the expulsion of half of Palestine's population. Nothing justifies such an inhuman barbarity. The fourth point I would like to make is that we should not forget in such a tribunal what the Palestinian community inside Israel has undergone, especially in the period 1948 to 1966, when it was subjected to a policy of mandatory emergency regulations that restricted every human and civil right that that Palestinian minority had. It's important to understand that historical period between 1948 to 1966 because the very same military regime that was imposed on one-fifth of the Israeli citizens was transplanted into the West Bank and the Gaza Strip in 1967. So the Jewish state, in many ways, is a long history of systematic violation of human rights and civil rights, not just its policy towards the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, and I hope we are not going to forget this in this important tribunal. And finally, I would like to explain again the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, because there is a tendency, a very natural tendency, to look at the history of the occupation as if it is not part of a longer history of colonization and dispossession. In 1967, the most consensual Israeli government ever, that included every political party in Israel in 1967, decided or took three decisions. The first decision was that the Palestinian population of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip would not be ethnically cleansed, as the Palestinians of 80% of Palestine were ethnically cleansed in 1948. The second decision was that these territories cannot be in de jure annexed to the State of Israel, that you cannot officially annex these areas, because if you annex them officially, you are, unlike in 1948, are going to encounter international rejection. The last decision that was taken was that if you do not expel the people and you do not annex officially the territories, you have to decide what would be the status of the people there. And there and then in 1967 fell the decision to create something which we have never seen anywhere else in modern history. The idea of citizenless citizens in a mega prison that was built in 1967. That mega prison, as you can see today, has two versions. One version is a maximum security facility. The other model is the one that attracted the world's attention and produced a lot of scholarship and a lot of support. That's the idea of the open prison. The open prison is a gift given by the Israelis to the Palestinians in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip should they behave according to the Israelis' ideas of reconciliation. And when they accept it, they can have autonomous life. And the idea of autonomy develops in the 1980s into the idea of a Bantustan, a mini-state. We always have to remember the idea of two states is a Zionist idea. No normal Palestinian would ever suggest to divide his or her homeland into two states. That doesn't stand to reason altogether. If we are going to seek a just and peaceful solution to the raging conflict there, we should include everyone who is affected and who was affected so that we can build together a stable future. Thank you.
We will now have a reflection or input from Mr. Ben White, a very well-known journalist and writer, activist as well, who will speak to us on Israeli policies since 1948.
I'm going to begin just by touching on a few elements of what it means for Israel to be defined as a Jewish state, and obviously specifically the implications of that for the Palestinian people. I wanted to begin that by pointing out the way in which in the very first few years of the state's establishment, key laws that were passed, particularly the law of return, the absentee property law, and the citizenship law, were the sort of foundation stones for a regime of exclusion, and were defining who was in and who was out in this new state. Israel doesn't have a formal constitution, and something has been mentioned of the basic laws that Israel has passed, which obviously kind of regulate various aspects of the state, like the role of the Knesset and the army and so forth. I just wanted to mention one basic law, the basic law Human Dignity and Liberty from 1992, which is a useful way of highlighting the disparity or the problematic nature of the relationship between Israel's identity as both Jewish and democratic. Because this basic law, while on the surface offering some sort of protection to minorities within the state, actually has an important qualifying clause within the basic law that effectively says those rights can be abrogated in the event that it is important to protect the nature of Israel as a Jewish state. It was only the ethnic cleansing of 1948 that enabled the establishment of a Jewish majority in the first place. After that, a number of laws were used to further the expropriation of land from the Palestinian population, and not just the Palestinians who had been expelled, but also from Palestinians who had remained and become citizens, and effectively the transference of Palestinian-owned land into the hands of the state, sometimes via those organizations I mentioned, the para-state organizations. Quote-unquote, abandoned Palestinian property was given over for the establishment of new Jewish communities. And for example, in areas like Nakab, the Negev in the south, the remaining Bedouin Palestinians were confined to an area that was referred to as the fence in order for the area that they had been occupying to be freed up for Jewish settlement. I also wanted to mention the fact that until today, the Israeli state has a focus or an interest in what it refers to as Judaization of areas like the Negev and the Galilee, areas that have kept a relatively high number of Palestinian citizens compared to other areas of the state. That discourse of the demographic threat is commonplace amongst Israeli academics, think tanks, politicians, laypersons, the general public. The idea that Palestinians with citizenship are a threat to the state simply by the fact that they are Palestinians. And if you're wanting to see how that works out in practice, then you can remember the fact that the law that currently means that Palestinian citizens, Israeli citizens, can't legally live with their spouse, if that spouse is a Palestinian from the West Bank and Gaza, the motivation for that law is not security, but a desire to make sure that Palestinians don't gain citizenship through marriage in the context of the demographic struggle. And then, of course, what happened after 1967 was that the same colonial logic was extended to the West Bank and Gaza, remembering West Bank including East Jerusalem too. And I'm sure many of us are familiar with what's happened since 67 in terms of the creation and consolidation of the colonies, the illegal settlements. Subsequently, that regime has been expanded to include the separation wall, the road network that connects the settlements to each other, various other kind of ways of limiting Palestinian access to territory, such as the creation of areas reserved for the Israeli military to train in, and these sorts of things. And to the extent that by now, in 2012, you have the existence of a de facto one state, a de facto single regime from the river to the sea, where the Israeli state sets policies that discriminate and make a difference on people's lives, depending on where they are and what sort of ID they have and what ethnicity they are. Now, I'm going to touch upon as well, just I want to briefly, economic marginalization and the way in which the Israeli state has targeted Palestinian economic, the ability for Palestinians to generate kind of independent economics, not just within the West Bank and Gaza, but also inside 48 area as well. There are tons of statistics to show the levels of inequality between Jewish and Palestinian citizens within 48. Just to give you a couple of examples of these. In 2003, this figure was from close to half of all Palestinian families lived in poverty compared to around one in five Jewish Israeli families. In 2010, Palestinian citizens accounted for a third of all poor people in Israel. Out of the 30 communities in Israel with the most unemployment, 27 of them are Palestinian communities. There's no practical means for the Palestinians to develop an independent economy. I'm going to mention as well the fact that when you're talking about the displacement of the Palestinians, you're not just talking about something that happened in history. Okay? It's an ongoing Nakba that didn't finish in 49 or 50 or even 67, but is carrying on today. If you took a sample of events that have happened with regards to the displacement of Palestinians over the last few years, you'll notice that very similar things have happened to Palestinians in Nakab, in the south, in the same way that Palestinians in the Jordan Valley or the southern Hebron Hills have been expelled and had their properties demolished too. And in both cases, it's with the same goal in mind, that of furthering or enabling Jewish settlement and making sure that space is cleared for that. And marginalizing or eradicating the presence of the Palestinian communities there too.
We'd like to call Mr. Peter Henson. He will deal with the topic United Nations involvement in Palestine from the mandate to the present.
I think it's worthwhile mentioning that the concept of justice as being something that always flows from international universal organizations like the League or the UN is not necessarily something one should take without a very large grain of salt. In the mandate for Palestine, unlike all the other mandates, the cards were stacked against Palestine by having the Balfour Declaration written into it. So whereas other mandate areas of the League could go on fairly simply, not very simply, but they could go forward and have states formed, which was not really the case for Palestine, that already in the mandate had written into it, by the way, you have to make space for the Jews as a homeland. And that is one case in which the cards were stacked against Palestine from the very beginning. Ilan made reference to the resolution 181 and the distribution of land and population at the time. It was not a very fair deal that the Palestinians were offered. A great majority in their land were giving the smaller part of their territory, and the smaller group was given the larger part of the land. After a first, if you will, normative activism with the resolution 181, partition resolution, and I should mention also resolution 194 about the right of return. It's a norm and it's a principle that you don't bring up in polite discourse in Israel, and that you don't bring up in polite discourse anymore, even in the United Nations resolutions and negotiations. You can refer to relevant resolutions and so on and imply resolution 194, but you don't even mention it anymore. It has gone so far out of use, almost as being seen as being illegitimate to quote as a basic right of the Palestinians. For a long time, there was a complete lull then in UN engagement with the issue. Palestinian issue in the UN was basically reduced to a question of humanitarian issues. What do we do with the poor people? How do we feed them and give them tents and what have you for basic survival? And it took a war, namely the 1967 war, to bring the Palestinian issue back in any meaningful form in the UN. And here we again see a UN norm or UN decision being this time formulated and stated by the Security Council, namely a resolution 242 with its Land for Peace edict setting the framework for all discussions about peace in the area. We have had Palestine now as a fixed agenda item for many, many years since resolution 32-36 in 94 that established the right to self-determination, national independence, and sovereignty. And we've had an annual reconfirmation of this, of these Palestinian rights. One might dismiss this as so much more paper going through the UN mill, but if we didn't have it, the Palestinian question might run the risk of the destiny it had from the founding of Israel until the 67 war of being basically forgotten. Now, activity in the UN on this takes part as a number of large number of UN resolutions on Palestine every General Assembly. And it takes place in a series of meetings in the Security Council. So whereas the normative function works, the functions that should help implement these norms have been completely stalemated in the Security Council, and we all know that it has been the United States that has provided a great many vetoes. I don't think I'm speaking unduly negatively when I say that it has this process that is now more and more written in inverted commas, of course, and that's justified, has degenerated into an exercise in futility. And to the people watching this process for the, what is it, 22nd year or something like that, for these people and for the people in Palestine, has become a cruel joke. And I can think of it only as a cruel joke every time I hear politicians in Europe and in the United States making great references to the process and trying to give people hope that this process is going to lead anywhere. If you look at where US interests have been reflected very strongly, it has certainly not been in imposing or in insisting on principles of international law. It has been every time, again and again, to favor an Israeli position, humanitarian. And again, that's a function, humanitarian operations, to which I have been particularly attached. UNRWA, the largest UN agency anywhere, 30,000 staff, some almost 5 million Palestinians are registered with UNRWA. You cannot go anywhere in the world and see a larger UN presence than you do in the occupied territories. In Gaza, it is very, very strong. You can barely drive a kilometer without seeing an UNRWA school or an UNRWA clinic or anything. And no doubt, UNRWA has a lot of contributions that they have made in education, in health, in social affairs, again. But significant as these achievements are, shouldn't we stop and ask that, should we only be dealing with the symptoms? Should we only be treating a cancer with a Band-Aid? Is humanitarian action not a substitute for what the UN has never been able to deliver, namely political solutions? And the UN, I'm afraid, comes up very short on that. My experience as head of this organization for these many years was that I was not supposed to talk about anything except how to get the trucks to the delivery places or get the school programs organized from year to year. Questions about the reasons behind the need for humanitarian assistance was not welcome, really, to be commented upon from my side or from the agency's side in the larger donor community. They like to think that they have bought redemption. They, after all, give some money every year, so what else do you want us to do? And then UNRWA becomes a very, very bad excuse and a cover for non-action and an excuse for political passivity.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to start our afternoon session, and the first witness is Professor John Quigley.
I want to take up some themes that were initiated this morning, in particular in Peter Hansen's discussion about the United Nations and what might be done there. And I also want to touch on the policy of the United States with respect to those matters, and in particular that of Palestine statehood. There are several key aspects of it. I mean, one is the question of whether Palestine really is a state. But I think it's quite clear that it is a state. If you look at the Treaty of Lausanne of 1924, the treaty that ended the First World War, you find the major powers are referring to Iraq, to Syria, to Palestine as being states. And the Permanent Court of International Justice, the court that preceded the current International Court of Justice, in a decision during the 1920s, also very clearly said that Palestine was a state as a successor to the Ottoman Empire in the territory of Palestine. The other issue about how to proceed at the United Nations relates to membership. One thing that I think is possible is that the General Assembly could deal with the membership issue on its own. That is, forget the Security Council and admit Palestine to membership. And it is generally assumed that the General Assembly does not have such a power. But in fact, I think it does. This comes under Article 4 of the Charter of the United Nations, which says that the General Assembly admits new members upon recommendation of the Security Council. So the question is, what does upon recommendation of the Security Council mean? Does it have to be a favorable recommendation, or does the General Assembly simply have to get some kind of advice, as it were, on the matter from the Security Council? And it has been widely assumed that the Security Council does have the role of being able to stop it. That is, that the General Assembly cannot do this on its own. If you go back to the drafting history of Article 4, however, it is quite clear that the opposite is what was intended in Article 4. That is, that the intent behind the language upon recommendation of the Security Council was that would be advisory only. The other issue that I'll just mention briefly, where I think the United States has played a particularly a negative role, is on the question of how one assesses the initiation of the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza in 1967. On a variety of issues, you find the government of Israel justifying its position, justifying its continued retention of control, for example, by saying that it acted defensively in 1967, that Egypt was about to attack it, and that Israel needed to use military force against Egypt preemptively. If you look at what the foreign minister of Israel, Abba Ibn, told the Security Council and the General Assembly in 1967, that's not what he was telling them. He was telling them that Egypt had in fact attacked. It was a concocted story, but that was the justification that the government of Israel gave at the time. And the United States was quite aware that this was not true. The United States had been very active in trying to discourage Israel from attacking Egypt all through the spring of 1967. The United States kept telling Israel, no, Egypt is really not going to attack you. You don't need to attack Egypt. And the Israeli government in particular, Abba Ibn, kept coming back and saying, oh yes, we have information that Egypt is about to attack. And finally, actually, the head of the Mossad came to Washington and admitted to Robert McNamara that Egypt was not about to attack, even in the estimation of Israeli intelligence. But after the war went as it did, with a very quick victory for Israel, the United States covered up what it knew about the run-up to the war. And continues to do so to the present time. I mean, I think it's the current view of the U.S. government that Israel acted defensively in 1967. And I think that is something that does need to be challenged, you know, in various ways at the UN and in the public discussion about a wide range of issues, including in particular the settlements in the West Bank.
Our next speaker is Professor Goland Dabas, and she will be speaking to the item, the United Nations, what is the legal responsibility of an intergovernmental organization?
My testimony today will focus on the central responsibility of the United Nations for Palestine. It's going to seek to demonstrate One, that the question of Palestine cannot be regarded as a bilateral matter left to negotiations between Israel and Palestine, but that it has a central responsibility to promote self-determination and statehood within the framework of the United Nations roadmap, which is set in place as early as 1947. The first point is that it has a central responsibility for Palestine on the basis of the UN roadmap. Secondly, my testimony will seek to underline the failure of the UN to carry out this responsibility. Thirdly, my testimony will seek to query whether such failure of the United Nations to take action may, in certain circumstances, lead to the UN to incur responsibility in a strict legal sense. In other words, it will address the accountability of the UN under international law. Now, in this session, I'm going to trace the historical origins and the legal foundations of UN responsibility and the double standards in the Security Council. So what are the origins and foundation of this responsibility? First, Palestine is of UN concern because it raises issues which lie at the heart of the purposes and principles of the United Nations: threats to the peace, right to self-determination, human rights. Second, the territory, which corresponds for the UN to the territory occupied in 1967, has an internationally protected status under international law. This has been collectively recognized, including by the ICJ. The Security Council has laid down a normative framework for occupied territory, in particular that of Palestine. It has, for example, determined the illegality under international law of this occupation. It's called for withdrawal. And it has also, very importantly, declared the nullity or invalidity of all legislative and administrative measures taken by Israel which purport to alter the character and status of the occupied territory. For example, it declared that Israel's 1980 Basic Law establishing Jerusalem as the complete and united capital of Israel is null and void. And it has also determined, very importantly, that Israeli settlements in the occupied Palestinian territory, including East Jerusalem, is established in flagrant violation of the Geneva Conventions. I want to come now to the failure of the UN to ensure compliance. Even though the Security Council has determined in other situations, in exactly the same terms as Palestine, the violations of human rights, the threats to international peace and security, and has enforced vigorously all of its other resolutions in other situations, in the case of Palestine, this has been notably absent. In its practice, the Council has determined that conduct in violation of norms like genocide, ethnic cleansing, and so on, and serious breaches of human rights, including the right to self-determination, and breaches of humanitarian law, constitute threats to international peace and security. It has to date adopted a series of extremely vigorous measures. The Council has established an international presence ranging from far-reaching fact-finding and monitoring systems to peacekeeping operations with extended mandates, even allowed to use force in self-defense. There are currently 16 UN peace operations deployed on four continents. The ICJ confirmed that the construction of a wall in the OPT created a fait accompli, which, if it became permanent, would be tantamount to de facto annexation. In other words, that area between the armistice line and the wall would incorporate more than 16% of the territory of the West Bank, including within that area around 80% of Israeli settlers. And the court underlined, remember that what we're talking about in the occupied Palestinian territory, 22% of historic Palestine. And the court continued by saying, cutting the Palestinian territories into barely contiguous territorial units would, of course, threaten the potential of any future viable Palestinian state, but could generate another exodus, thus risking further alterations to the demographic composition of the occupied Palestinian territory. The Council's reactions to grave breaches of humanitarian law committed against Palestinians have lacked robust enforcement. In terms of fact-finding, The Council has been unwilling to adopt fact-finding missions under Chapter 7 authority. It has shielded itself behind the UN Secretary General, merely welcoming his initiative. For example, Jenin refugee camp. And even when the Israeli IDF in Gaza caused deaths, injuries, and damage to UN property in 7 incidents, it was on the initiative of the Secretary General, not of the Security Council, that a 4-member board of inquiry was established. And that, I point out, was the report was never fully published. It was only an executive summary. I want to point out also that the Security Council has given a central place to the problem of refugees. It has called on a number of occasions to the right of return of refugees and displaced persons. And that residents, the council says, it is said in a resolution on Georgia, that individual property rights have not been affected by the fact that the owners had to flee during the conflict, and that residency rights and identity of those owners will be respected. So we see, again, in questions of refugee issues, the difference when 194 is also considered a taboo question at all. Now, I come to the conclusion of this session by simply saying, by underlining that the situation in Palestine and Israeli policies and practices may be described in similar terms to the great number of cases that I have outlined or have not outlined, which were before the Security Council. That in stark contrast, no enforcement action or other remedy was ordered by the Security Council. We've spoken today about the veto this morning. We all know why the Security Council has been unable to act. From 1983 to the present, I'm not very good on statistics, but I think that the US cast around 22 vetoes on Palestine from 83 to the present. It was alone among the permanent members. It was always the single permanent member that vetoed. And it vetoed resolutions which were where the content was accepted by the United Nations, by international law. Settlements, for example, Israeli practices, expropriation of land, and so on and so forth. So I want to end this part by saying that it is this virtual immunity which Israel enjoys from the measures that are routinely applied by the Council that's had a very damaging impact on attempts to persuade the Israeli government to engage in a true peace process rather than the one that we referred to this morning.
I would like now to invite Professor Susan Akram to the podium, and Professor Akram will be speaking on Palestinian refugees and the United Nations.
The Palestinian people constitute one of the largest and longest standing unresolved situations of displacement in the world. About half the refugees in the world are Palestinian. Approximately 66%, or 7.4 million, of the entire population of 11.2 million Palestinians is forcibly displaced. Among those displaced are at least 6.8 million Palestinian refugees and another 519,000 internally displaced persons. In addition to refugees are Palestinians who are internally displaced within historic Palestine and Israel. There's ongoing Palestinian displacement in all categories until today due to Israeli measures such as home demolitions, residency cancellations or restrictions, ongoing military actions, land seizures, and other actions forcing Palestinians out of their homes and lands virtually every day. Now, the majority of Palestinian and IDP internally displaced population remains in the Middle East, in the Arab countries bordering Israel and the occupied territories. Underlying the contentious nature of the Palestinian refugee problem is a lack of consensus about who is a Palestinian refugee as a matter of law. What rights apply to them? Whether they're entitled to protection from the international community, and what obligations the United Nations has towards this population. Refugees around the world simply by recognition of their status are guaranteed through treaty and through UN agencies, primarily the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, or UNHCR, the intervention of the international community in seeking and implementing their rights to return home, to obtain integration in host countries, resettlement in third states, restitution of their properties, and a whole host of core rights that are guaranteed and in fact being implemented every day as we speak around the world for other refugees. Now, the Israeli position disputes whether Palestinians are refugees at all, whether the UN has any special obligation towards them, and hence whether they're entitled to the durable solutions required for other refugees as a matter of international law and practice. These positions, due to the weakness of the UN framework and the failure of the UN to enforce the large body of resolutions it has passed in support of Palestinian refugee rights, have permeated all the negotiations for a settlement to the conflict, contributing to an erosion of rights recognition with serious consequences for a durable solution, a just solution of the refugee problem. Although no clear definition of Palestinian refugee is incorporated in the language of Resolution 194, the UNCCP's authoritative analysis of paragraph 11 of this resolution gives the definition that the delegates were relying on, and that is the term refugees applies to all persons who have been displaced from their homes in Palestine. UNRWA has defined Palestine refugees for its purposes as any person whose normal place of residence was Palestine during the period 1st June 1946 to 15 May 1948, who lost both home and means of livelihood as the result of the 48 conflict. Although UNRWA has expanded its definition over the course of time and dropped the specific needs-based requirement, registration remains on an individual basis and for specific categories of those refugees found in the UNRWA areas. The term Palestine refugee for UNRWA is a much different and much more restricted meaning than that for the UNCCP and for General Assembly Resolution 194. Now we come to the third definition. The third definition relevant to Palestinians as refugees is that incorporated into two provisions of the 1951 Convention relating to the status of refugees. This is the universal treaty that protects and guarantees the rights of refugees around the world. And the two important provisions are Articles 1A2 and Articles 1D. I'm sorry to give you the numbers, but it helps us to keep them straight. The Article 1A2 definition, which is referred to as the universal definition of refugee because it has been basically universally adopted by states, has been widely misunderstood in reference to Palestinians and in relation to that other provision, Article 1D. Now, Article 1D's two clauses have been subjected to widely divergent interpretations by states, the UN, and experts in the field. The most widely held interpretation is that 1D is an exclusion clause preventing Palestinians from being recognized as refugees, since UNRWA is assumed to be providing them international protection. Two other provisions apply to the status of Palestinians as subjects of international law that I will just briefly mention. They're important here. Article 1 of the Stateless Persons Convention and paragraph 7C of the statute of the UNHCR. Both incorporate exclusion clauses similar to the first sentence of Article 1D, and the Palestinians are the only ones who qualify for being excluded from those instruments. The prevalent interpretation of these provisions has had very severe consequences for Palestinians seeking benefits as refugees, as stateless, and as displaced persons worldwide. As a result, Palestinians have been precluded from many of the critical aspects of international protection, the most important of which is their long-term desire for protection, intervention, and mechanisms for obtaining a durable solution to their condition as refugees and as stateless persons. However, the drafting history indicates that 1D was intended to only conditionally exclude Palestinians from the main treaties that were focused, after all, on the obligations of resettlement states, because the solution for their condition was repatriation to their homes and homeland and not resettlement. The consensus that was embodied in Resolution 194's Para 11 incorporates a very specific durable solution in a particular hierarchy of order. Return, number one, restitution of property and compensation for Palestinian refugees. The definition of Palestinian refugees referenced in Resolution 194 related to the entire population of Palestinians who were displaced from Palestine, and it was this entire population that was to have the benefit of a special protection regime guaranteed by the UN in the creation of two agencies dedicated just to the Palestinians, one to ensure implementation of the required durable solution, UNCCP, and one to ensure humanitarian assistance until the refugees could return home, UNRWA. Because this separate and special regime had already been established by the time the refugee and stateless conventions were drafted, the UN delegates did not want the Palestinian refugees to be subsumed with other refugees in the new treaty scheme that focused on resettlement. Hence, they omitted Palestinians from these treaties and the mandates of these agencies that were to implement them. The second clause of Article 1D was drafted to ensure that if either of the UN agencies set up for their protection was to fail, Palestinians would automatically be covered by the refugee treaties and the UNHCR. So where are we today? With no agreed upon refugee protection definition that applies to the entire population of Palestinian refugees and displaced persons, and no agency with a durable solutions mandate towards the entire affected population, the protection gap for this population is evident.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, Raji Sarani is not able to be with us this afternoon. However, Jean Mira, a labor lawyer from New York who is president of the International Association of Democratic Lawyers and who has just returned from Gaza, will be making a presentation on behalf of Raji and behalf of herself.
Gaza is a small section of land whose north coast is the Mediterranean Sea. It is completely surrounded by Israel on the east and south and shares a border with Egypt on the west. It is 360 square kilometers, about 140 square kilometers, and currently has a population of 1.6 million. It is considered the most densely populated section of land on Earth. To say that it is an open-air prison for 1.6 million people is not an exaggeration. It is a systematic degradation, humiliation, isolation, and fragmentation of the Palestinian people. It separates families, as there is no travel between the West Bank and Gaza. The economic dependency reinforces an ongoing humanitarian crisis so as to promote divisions and so as to disrupt the emergence of a Palestinian state. In its report, PCHR states, the economic impact of the prolonged illegal closure of Gaza is pervasive. It has paralyzed all economic sectors and resulted in the emergence of a man-made, completely preventable humanitarian crisis. The fishing industry, for which Gaza is famous and which previously employed a large segment of the population, is being wiped out as it is forced into increasingly small fishing area by Israeli gunships, which frequently fire at and wound and kill Palestinian fishermen and confiscate fishing boats and equipment. The waters close to the Mediterranean shore, the Mediterranean Sea, are shallow. The fishermen told us that in order to really catch anything substantial, the boats need to go out at least 6 miles. But since the absolute closure, Israelis have hemmed fishermen in supposedly to 3 miles, but it's not really 3 miles. During the last day we were in Gaza, two fishermen were fired upon by Israeli gunships and they were only 1.5 miles off the shore. One of the fishermen was wounded, and one of them died the day after we left. In August 2012, the UN country team in occupied Palestinian territory issued a report entitled Gaza in 2020, a livable place? In this report, the UN predicts that the population of Gaza will be 2.13 million by 2020. The water demands will increase, but the aquifer will likely become unusable by 2016, and the damage to it irreversible by 2020. If massive investments in water treatment and desalinization plants are not taken immediately, the whole population of Gaza will be subject to a water crisis of genocidal proportions in a very few years. More than 71,000 housing units are needed now to address the crisis from cast lead, and many more will be needed by 2020 to address the increase in population. 93% of Gaza's power is dependent on fuel from Israel to Gaza power plant. The damage to the grid from cast lead and the unstable receipt of fuel from Israel has resulted in daily power cuts to most of Gaza. These cuts last from 8 to 12 hours a day. By 2020, the demand for power will double, but there is no way under current conditions that the people of Gaza will be able to fix the current grid, find new sources of renewable energy, or explore the gas reserves of the Gaza Marine offshore gas field in time. The international community is in effect subsidizing the occupation and closure. The amount of money it takes to keep the closure in place and Israel's refusal to acknowledge its duties under the Fourth Geneva Convention has meant that through UNRWA, which is also dependent on private as well as international community donations, must fill the gap. The international community is thereby subsidizing these illegal acts so as to provide the barest of necessity of food and shelter and education to the people of Gaza. Although this aid is a matter of life and death for the people of Gaza, and in the refugee camps, it would be much better if the people in Gaza were able to use their talents to build their country and not be dependent on the world for aid. As lawyers, we have been taught that where there is a wrong, there must be a remedy. In fact, the duty to punish countries that engage in wars of aggression is codified in the Nuremberg Principles. The duty to punish grave breaches of the international humanitarian law are stated in the Geneva Conventions themselves. The problem is, however, that Israel has been hiding behind its defenders in the United States and NATO countries to prevent the Goldstone report, prevent action on the Goldstone report. The action suggested was that if either party failed to actually investigate itself and take action against the perpetrators, the matter should be referred to the International Criminal Court. This action has been stalled by the UN. Pressure was placed on Goldstone to renounce some of his findings. The efforts by the Palestinian Authority in the past to get the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, Mr. Ocampo, to accept the charges against Israel filed with the ICC and to open investigation have thus far proved futile, as the prosecutor last April stated he could not investigate the crimes as the Palestinian Authority was not a state. Lawyers around the world have tried to address this impunity by using the concept of universal jurisdiction, the concept that some crimes are so heinous that every country has a duty to investigate and prosecute them, regardless of whether they took place on their soil. This tribunal has an important role in making the moral and legal case for accountability and reparation. I thank you for the opportunity to present the case of Gaza. Thank you.
So what is the IADL's position on sociocide as well?
I think to the extent I understand the concept, we probably would agree with it, that it is happening. I mean, the precursor to genocide really relates to the water. I mean, you cannot live without water. And the aquifer is about to be completely destroyed. Where are those people going to live? I mean, if this isn't genocide, it's certainly a crime against humanity.
We are very pleased to open the second day of the Russell Tribunal on Palestine. We have many wonderful speakers to bear witness and to speak to us. And the first one is Diana Bhutu, who will talk to us about the U.S.'s role in Palestine and the Middle East.
I've decided this morning to deviate away from the written comments that I had initially provided and instead just try to give some testimony in terms of what is going on and how the U.S. is affecting Palestine and undermining Palestinian rights. I wanted to use my own personal experience and to share some stories of people who live in Palestine, rather than going into a long treatise about the UN and the US and their role in the undermining of Palestinian rights. One area where there hasn't been an abdication, in which there has been a specific undermining, is that of the United States and the role that it has played in Palestine. The United States has deliberately attempted to change the rules of the game and to make legal what is otherwise illegal. Now, I'm not somebody who is, although I'm a lawyer, I'm not somebody who is obsessed by law. I think that we generally know what is just and what is unjust. And what the United States has attempted to do in Palestine is to make what is unjust seem just, what is illegal seem legal. Now, I want to first step back and pick up a little bit on what Ilan Pappe said yesterday. And Ilan said yesterday that what Israel's goal had been from 48 until the current day is to create a Jewish state in an area that was never Jewish. And the way that it was done was first through the expulsion of more than 75% of the Palestinian population in 1948, and then later through the containment of the Palestinians by viewing them either as a demographic threat or viewing them as a security threat. And so Israel's role and the mechanisms that it used was to try to confine Palestinians into as small spaces as possible and take as much of their land as possible. And this has been a process that has gone on since 1948 and continues on to this very day. This is why in 1993, when the Oslo Accords were signed, the remaining 22% of Palestine that had come under occupation in 1967 was now further subdivided into areas A, areas B, areas C, with area A, a small, tiny little portion of land, less than 18% of the 22%, the area in which the vast majority of Palestinians lived, an area in which it was now delegated to the Palestinian Authority, and we'll talk about that a little bit further. The remainder of the land, the vast majority of the land, area C, more than 60% of the land, was an area and remains an area that is under direct Israeli control. If you look back to as far back as the 1967, up until the Reagan administration, the U.S. position when it came to Israeli settlements was that Israeli settlements were illegal and that they were a violation of international law. Following the peace process, and most specifically with President Clinton, that position changed to no longer being a question of illegal and a violation of international law, but now being a, quote, obstacle to peace. All right. Now fast forward to where there are now 600,000 settlers, and under the Obama administration, no longer are the settlements illegal and contrary to international law. No longer are they an obstacle to peace. But now the U.S. position is that continued settlement activity is illegitimate. Continued settlement activity is illegitimate. And so the question becomes, continuing since when? And what does illegitimate mean? In other words, the policy has been whittled down from being one that is illegal to now focusing on the continued settlement activity as being illegitimate, not illegal. And what this means is that in every context in which the U.S. has put its hands, and we hear this time and time again, and I'm sure there are some people in this room who will repeat this, who say, we all know what the solution looks like. We all know what a settlement looks like. I hear this time and time and time again. And for each person who says to me, we know what the settlement looks like, we know what the solution looks like, I ask them, really? What does it look like? What exactly is going to happen to these Israeli settlements? And in each configuration, I hear the same thing over and over again. Well, you know, we'll just redraw the borders in such a way as to accommodate these Israeli settlements. So in other words, the United States and Israel have both succeeded. They've succeeded in making legal what is otherwise illegal. They've succeeded in making acceptable what is otherwise reprehensible through this policy of simply looking towards and trying to get Palestinians to accept these settlements. Now, it's very interesting when you look at the role that the United States has played within the UN, and we heard a great deal yesterday about the role that the UN itself has not played. And it's very interesting when you look at the number of vetoes that the United States has used over the course of the past decades. There have been, from my estimations, roughly 82 times that the United States has used the veto. Very interestingly, half of those times has been for Israel's benefit, virtually half. And when you add in the number of times that the United States has used the veto in order to support apartheid South Africa, that number becomes 70%. So in other words, the United States, in terms of its usage and trying to make legal what is otherwise illegal, it has done it both in the case of South Africa apartheid and in the case of Palestine.
What does the United States gain from its interference in the policies of this foreign country? Why does the United States veto all these resolutions in the General Assembly of the United Nations?
I think it's important to keep in mind that this is not a one-way street. In other words, it's not simply a question of the United States supporting Israel. But the United States is also benefiting from this whole system and from this relationship. And what I mean by that is, if you look back and if you look at what's going on now and you see the parallels in terms of what's going on in Israel and what's going on in the United States, they're quite similar. For example, the idea of the preemptive strike, which somebody talked about yesterday, the idea of a preemptive strike was first put forward by Israel. The United States has since adopted that position, that they have the right to do a preemptive strike on any country. That's one. Two is, if you look at the wall, the issue of the wall, there is a wall that the Israelis have built in the West Bank and in the Gaza Strip, by the way, there's also a wall there. The United States is also building a wall on its border with Mexico. The issue of Guantanamo Bay and the procedures that have been used in Guantanamo Bay were largely adopted from the Israeli system. The whole procedure of administrative detainees is a procedure that has been lifted from the Israelis. The idea of drones and the drones that Imam Muhammad was talking about, this woman I was talking about, are also being used by the United States. So it's not simply a one-way street in which the United States is giving Israel support. The United States is also using this. And in flipping it, it's on its head, is also trying to change what's going on in this country as well. It's not just simply a one-way street. Now, there is also a number of other factors. One is, of course, the Israel lobby, which I know somebody's going to talk about today. There's also the question of the military aid and the militarization, et cetera. I mean, these are all issues that are involved. There is an element of Christian Zionism as well. But I think that it's you can't simply point to one issue and say it's the Israel lobby, or it's the Christian Zionist lobby, or a wide variety of things. It's a number of reasons, and one of the reasons that I think many people have overlooked is the fact that the United States also benefits from this.
Okay, now we're going to hear from Catherine Gallagher.
In light of the potential breadth of the topic that I have, I will provide testimony that demonstrates the various fora and means by which the United States supports, directly and indirectly, Israel and its military, and shields Israel from those intergovernmental mechanisms intended to ensure compliance with international law and accountability for its breaches. Since the creation of Israel, the United States has provided approximately $115 billion in bilateral assistance to Israel, Most of this aid has come in the form of military assistance. The United States phased out economic aid in the mid-1990s. Israel is the largest recipient of military aid and the second largest recipient of total U.S. aid worldwide. Israel receives 60% of the U.S. foreign military finance funding. In 2007, the United States and Israel entered into a memorandum of understanding by which the United States agreed to provide $30 billion in military aid over 10 years. As detailed in other sessions of the tribunal, the U.S. supplied weapons and military equipment have been implicated in gross human rights violations and violations of international law, including war crimes. There has been no disincentive for Israel to stop committing war crimes and other violations of international law. As has just been said, the United States has used its veto power in 82 cases, and approximately half of these instances have been to protect Israel from condemnation, including in relation to suspected war crimes. In the last decade, the United States has vetoed, otherwise blocked, or delayed resolutions condemning the killing of a UN worker and the destruction of the World Food Program warehouse, condemning the building of the wall, and condemning incursions into Gaza, including the 2009 Operation Cast Lead.
Catherine, thank you very much for your excellent report. My question to you is, why does President Obama, who has promised us that his vision is a nuclear-free world, and his administration, why do they allow Israel to threaten Iran with war when Iran has signed a nuclear non-proliferation treaty and doesn't have nuclear weapons, as did not Iraq, a country destroyed by America and the NATO forces? Why does the president allow Netanyahu to threaten Iran when Israel itself sits on over 200 nuclear weapons, has led the nuclear arms race in the Middle East, continues to lead the nuclear arms race in the Middle East? Why does the American president not say to Netanyahu, enough is enough, start getting rid of your nuclear weapons and sign the non-proliferation treaty?
It's an excellent question and an excellent comment. In terms of the reason for the why, I don't have a concrete answer, but I think the list of reasons that we heard in the last session of the importance of the U.S.-Israeli relationship as a two-way street is a large reason for this. It's a continuation of U.S. policy in some ways through a proxy, although at this point the relationship, who's leading and who's following, that can shift. But certainly we do see an absolute disconnect in the way that a nuclear-free world is talked about.
It's conceivable that U.S. policy might shift. For example, the United States might accept the proposals of the major human rights groups like Amnesty International, which called for an arms embargo on Israel, or Human Rights Watch, which called for an end to any U.S. aid to Israel that either is involved in any way with the settlements in the occupied territories or with discrimination within Israel. It's a strong demand coming from a central organization. There's plenty of popular support for that, even in the United States, and it could expand, it could lead to a change of policy. And if that doesn't happen, I think the prospects look pretty grim.
Cindy and Gray, Corrie, just arrived during the interview of Noam Chomsky.
Rachel was killed March 16th, 2003.
And from that point forward, we sought to find truth, accountability, and justice for what happened to her. We went through every possible effort, working with all branches of our government to try to secure a U.S. investigation, which we were told couldn't happen, and to find accountability. On August 28th, as you know, of this year, the judge, Judge Oded Gershon in Haifa District Court, found that the military had no culpability whatsoever, and found that determined that what happened was an act of war, and that therefore the military had no responsibility. Legally, of course, this has implications for every human being, but for particularly those that are confronted with the Israeli military. I'll leave you with one last piece. Our expectation is that the U.S. government will look at the verdict, and will look at the testimony that came out in the court and arrive at their own assessment about what happened. And that's something that we're going to need to pressure them to do, and we will be continuing to do.
The day after Rachel was killed, Prime Minister Sharon promised President Bush a thorough, credible, and transparent investigation. So that's coming from the highest regions of government. And it's still, as Cindy said, our government's position that sort of investigation has not happened. And even though we did file a lawsuit is not a substitution for an investigation. In fact, it's incredibly hampered by not having an investigation. Maybe this tribunal can do what, or at least help to do what so many governments have failed to do. But in a time right now where we're thinking about another time of having preemptive war, it's time for preemptive peace. It's time for preemptive justice. So we can't do, I don't know what justice means if, you know, if you back over with your car, you hit my car, I know you can replace my car. When you run over my daughter, I don't know what justice means that way. You have to prevent it from happening. And so we have to be preventive and preemptive in our justice.
We have Johan Galtung, who will make our first presentation on what is sociocide.
So my task is to try to define a concept I introduced in the mid-80s, sociocide. And my contention is that it is a concept at the same level as a genocide, the massive killing of a category of people just because they're members of that category, and ecocide, the killing of nature. What we mean by killing in genocide and ecocide is to get rid of their ability to reproduce themselves. And for that reason, when you are looking at genocide, the killing of women is often the most important part. When you look at ecocide, the killing of diversity and symbiosis of nature may be the most important part. The killing of a society is the killing of a social system's ability to reproduce itself. I know perfectly well that sociocide is not an object of positive international law. I can sense one reason why. This is what Western colonialism is about. It was also about killing. It was also about destroying nature. But it was above all tearing apart, fragmenting, marginalizing local indigenous societies. Basically, my point has been made. I've defined sociocide. I have taken as point of departure society as a social system with a capacity for self-reproduction. Don't confuse it with a country. The country may not be able to live up to that, and it may also have many societies inside, and the society may actually comprise more than one country. European Union is to some extent becoming a society, and to some extent not. All of this can be discussed, debated, but the social prerequisites are there.
again to take the ford, security, sustenance, identity and autonomy, to be master in your own house. And the modern version, the nation as the carrier of identity and the state as the principal responsible for autonomy.
Our next presenter is a professor of international law at Middlesex University in London. He's a professor of international criminal law and human rights at Leiden University, emeritus professor of human rights law at the National University of Ireland in Galway. He is William Shabas. Shabas.
I believe I was originally invited to testify on another topic when I was first contacted. And I was then subsequently asked to speak on this panel about sociocide, which I should confess was a term that really wasn't very familiar to me. I'm not a sociologist, I'm an international lawyer, as has been explained. And I would have, had I been asked to speak about use of international criminal law to address this problem, I would have been inclined to speak about crimes against humanity, war crimes, and the crime of aggression, all of which I think can be shown have been perpetrated at various times during the history of the State of Israel. The International Criminal Court is in a position to exercise jurisdiction over crimes committed on the territory of Palestine since 2002. I'm confident that sociocide has to be injected into the debate, and the nature of it that is described so well by Professor Galton has to inform the discussion and ultimately a report that will result from this, from these sessions. It might be useful to remind people that sociocide was very much a part of the original vision of genocide of the man who invented the term, Raphael Lemkin. I think it would also be very helpful to indicate that much, if not all, of what is contained in sociocide is now recognized as falling within the definition of crimes against humanity. I think this is it's important that we not lose sight of this, because I think there's a danger that in using a new term or in emphasizing a new term, it appears as if we're conceding the argument that the old terms don't apply. When I heard the chairs speaking about how sociocide applied to the, for example, the condition and the treatment, the historic treatment of Aboriginal peoples in the Americas, and I think elsewhere in the world, I thought, yes, sociocide, but also genocide. And I don't think you should, that anything should be said that suggests unease or anxiety about using that term. And when we talk about the treatment of Africans who were brought to the Americas as slaves, that is described as the crime against humanity of enslavement and of other crimes against humanity. And so I'm not sure it would be a positive development to suggest that we're giving that up, or that we feel that the existing terms are either not adequate or unsatisfactory or inapplicable. So I guess what I'm urging is that you find a way to marry these two notions, so that you enrich the debate with the notion of sociocide, but without implying that it's necessary to deal with the situation in the occupied territories. We already have much evidence that the existing international crimes address much of the worst that's happened. Yesterday you heard a discussion of the advisory opinion of the International Court of Justice. We have the report of the commission that was presided over by Richard Goldstone, And let me remind you that although Goldstone, rather notoriously now, has appeared to backtrack on a part of the report, most of the report and the worst of it, because the core of the report was about the campaign, not the behavior of individual soldiers in Gaza, but of the campaign of Israel to teach a lesson to the people of Gaza, learning from 2006 when it had taught a lesson to the people in Lebanon. And that point, from everything I've read of Richard Goldstone, is not retracted by him, and certainly none of the other three members of the commission have said anything to cast any doubt on their conclusions. So those arguments are made, and they're important, and the value of a body like the Russell Tribunal, amongst other things, is to insist on those things and to remind people of them and to make sure that they don't slip through our fingers. Thank you.
The question I want to ask is really stems from an experience I had at lunchtime. It's not the food, because I didn't have any. I chose to sit in here, and there was a film showing Where Should Birds Fly? Now, those of you who were in here would have been as shocked, even though I thought I knew what was going on, shocked as anybody could be about the appalling situation. And we've heard a lot about the appalling situation, but the film says it all. Farmers being shot at as I speak. Fishermen being sunk as I speak. Phosphorus burns from cast lead still taking their toll. It's in that context that I have a feeling, since there are so few Palestinians here today, for reasons that we'll come to later, that there's a sense of urgency, emergency, and that has to be communicated into legal redress. And I just want to give an example which is linked to everything that's being said. I'm involved in a campaign to make ecocide illegal, an international crime, the fifth international crime against the peace. I slot it in, again, if you can incorporate it in your response, because this has been discussed for 30 years. This was agreed by all the nations, save three, to go into the Treaty of Rome in 1998. It won't take too much imagination to work out the three who opposed it, because the three who might end up in the dock if it became a crime against the peace. And we still, there is an, if you like, an ambassador, a lawyer going around the world at the moment, Polly Higgins, trying to get governments to agree to it, and she still hasn't managed to get the consensus. So I'm going to be blunt. Sociocide is a very interesting concept, but I'm interested in the farmers, the fishermen, and the people in Palestine right now. So my question is this. Is there not sufficient material concepts within international law now? And I'm not talking about punishment. I'm not an international lawyer. I'm interested in transitional justice. Is there not sufficient concepts to start bringing Israel to a recognition that they will be excluded from the international community unless they recognize their failure on basic fundamental rights that we've all been talking about?
I would think that a very strong case can be made for much of what is ecocide, as well as a great deal of what is sociocide, for its inclusion within the concept of persecution as a crime against humanity, and other inhumane acts as crimes against humanity. Now, it's a choice, but often things move faster when you get a case before a handful of judges with a bit of imagination and courage than when you convene in an international conference and they start trying to negotiate the terms of it. It just gets worse. So I'm not against moving forward on both fronts, but I would be, if someone said you have to invest in one of them, I'd actually be more prone to saying, look at the tools we have and try to stretch them, but with the goal of putting the problems that you're concerned about, ecocide in particular, into the middle of the agenda, in the middle of the project. I think that's already possible. But it does require, it requires judges. And of course, the other challenge is finding the court to get it into. Years ago, there were no courts at all. When genocide was invented, there was no court at all. There was no court for crimes against humanity, but we have them now.
We know that what is at stake is more and more, not only a large group of human beings, like in the case of genocide, or of animals, like in the case of ecocide, but what is in front of us is something that is being brought to existence by the action of another nation or another society. It is to confront something which is a society or wants to be a society and is prevented from becoming a society as defined so rightly by Professor Galtung. Therefore, I think it is useful for the judges of the criminal tribunal to have this word as one of the words they can make use of and be called on for. And that may sometimes be quicker than to be able to tell them, look, in this case, what has been committed is largely similar to genocide. It isn't quite genocide, but it's nearly as bad. Or this is something else, and it can be defined as a criminal, international criminal action. Let us be brave enough to say, when a society is in case, and where that society is being prevented from going forward to arrive at its required status, then there is a crime, and that crime we call social crime. Thank you.
Our next presenter, a Palestinian socialite, will be by Salah Hamel.
My name is Saleh Abdel Jawad. SALEHABDALJAWAD, and not Saleh Hamayel. Hamayel is the clan name of my ancestors. The name was imposed to my family by the Israelis only a few weeks after they occupied the West Bank, including my town El Bira in 1967. The anthropologist of the Israeli Academia, same time officers in the Israeli army, thought that imposing old clanic and tribal names will facilitate the identification and control of the population and will renew and enforce the internal division of the population. Control and division are among the many methods to dominate Palestinian society. We are facing a completely unique situation. In the last 15 years, many terms and concepts appear to present a framework to understand Israeli colonial, settler, exclusionist system in Palestine. It is true that there are similarities between South African apartheid system and Israeli policies. There are also many, many differences. Racial segregation in South Africa between blacks, I'm talking now about similarities. Racial segregation between blacks and whites is similar to the segregation in Palestine between Jews and non-Jews. But the most important difference between us and South Africa is about the objectives of the colonizers. In South Africa, the blacks were to be exploited, and they are the main labor force. especially in mines and manual jobs. In the Israeli model, inspired by the North American model, the Arabs, like American Indians, were not part of the planned labor force. And you know, whenever a colonial settler situation never used the natives as labor force, their fate was always genocide, total physical extermination. Still, there are people who want to use the concept for different reasons. One of them, because this term is rooted in the international law. All our cultural, written heritage was destroyed or confiscated. It's, let's say, all these aspects together which oblige us to search for a new, let's say, definition. So the concept of sociocide denotes the processes that are used for achieving the total destruction of Palestinians, not only as a political national group, this is very important, but also as a society. I just want to say what is interesting also about sociocide and why we have, yes, to use this term. It's about the internal dynamics of sociocide, okay? Because, I mean, a lot of people talk about the wall. They said this is because of security, or this is because to take more land, or this is because transfer the population. But mainly for me, the wall is, the Israelis know their policy is creating a lot of anger inside the Palestinians. And the Palestinians are unable to export this anger toward the Israelis. So the wall, the main objective of the wall is to create a closed space where all this energy of anger destroy the Palestinians themselves.
What's the definition of apartheid under the Apartheid Convention?
I mean, for me, apartheid is...
No, sorry, not for you. I'm going to be precise. You've had the floor. I want an answer to this question, if you know it, since you've dismissed apartheid pretty well.
No, I'm...
Well, just answer the question. What are the terms, the definition of apartheid?
I didn't exclude apartheid.
What no, sorry, I said... sorry. Please answer the question. You've had a speech. What?
No. I think the witness is being badgered here. I'll give you an opportunity. There's so many questions that are here, and I've just been told that we don't have time.
But may I just follow it up then, and we'll leave
yes.
that. The apartheid definition, I'll read out. Because what I want to suggest is that everything you said is included in an existing definition of a crime that can be pursued. The convention describes it as inhuman acts committed for the purpose of establishing and maintaining domination by one racial group of persons over any other racial group of persons and systematically oppressing them. This was something that this tribunal found against Israel in our last session. In addition, one further matter. The Apartheid Convention also prohibits and includes ethnic cleansing, specifically Article 2BCD of the Convention Preventing the Crime of Apartheid. So all I want to say to you is that everything you've said is already there in crimes, I'm afraid.
Okay, can I answer? I mean, I will give you an example to show you that it's not there. In South Africa, the blacks were unable to swim with the whites with their beaches. But at least they have their own beaches. In Palestine, we are in the West Bank, don't have 1 meter on the Mediterranean Sea. We don't, all Palestinians in the West Bank never went to the sea since 17 years. So this is different. In South Africa, I will tell you, I am from a town called Elbira. Between Elbira and Betin is only 1 kilometer. In South Africa, the 1 kilometer will remain 1 kilometer. In the Palestinian case, we have to walk, we have to go 24 kilometers to arrive to the other village. Another, to come here, I was unable to go through Lod Airport. A black was able, used to take maybe Cape Town Airport or Johannesburg. But as a Palestinian, I was obliged to spend 8 hours in a journey to go to Amman. I am obliged to sleep in Amman and to come here. The time, the Israelis are occupying even the time, even our ability to organize and to program our life. This didn't happen in apartheid. So we have a different, we have totally different, I can give
no, I'm sorry,
at least
I'm sorry.
100 examples why it's different
okay.
from apartheid.
It's not different. Okay. It's different from South Africa.
Okay.
The point
okay.
I'm simply making.
Okay, Michael, because there are more people who want to speak. And I'm the next person who wants to speak. I would like to attach my remarks as well, or join my remarks with our witness, Salah Abdal Jawad, because I'm not Scottish. My name was changed. And so, you know, I agree with our witness who happens to say that apartheid isn't enough. Because from my people inside the United States, I don't know what religion, I don't know what country, I don't know what region from Africa. I mean, there's so much I don't know about my identity. And I have a right to have my identity. So I had some more things, but I'll. The chairman tells me I gotta shut up.
First of all, let me thank you for your testimony, and I would like to, I would like all of us to remind ourselves that we're not engaged in adversarial proceedings, that we are attempting to move towards the moment when we can formulate strategies that will allow us to move forward in the defense of Palestinian freedom. And I'll say that when I visited Palestine, my response was continually, this is worse than Jim Crow in the South. This is worse than apartheid. And so apartheid being a concept that has international resonance has been in part responsible for taking up the BDS campaign, the boycott, divestment, and sanctions campaign. And I'd like us to think about the strategic use of these terms in the context of what they enable us to do. And I hope that in the last session we can talk very specifically about how to build on the work of the previous tribunals, the tribunal in which apartheid was discussed in relation to Palestine in Cape Town. And in all three of the previous tribunals, there was a call for people to become more involved in the BDS campaign. So I want us to see these deliberations in the context of developing action agendas, which is, I think, why we are doing all of this in the first place.
I'd like to just make one comment. At the 1980 Russell Tribunal in Geneva, the word to describe the actions against Native Americans in this country was genocide. But I understand now the another meaning of sociocide, and I think that I think genocide is a lot stronger, only because, maybe because I've heard it longer, there's a complete massacre of an entire village and community and human beings. Whole tribes were wiped out. So that's how I view genocide. And sociocide, of course, cultural, the social conditions, both of them apply to both of us. So, but I want to thank you very much for your presentation and for your strong words.
One of the lines in the film that I saw at lunchtime, which is so devastating, the actual effects of what's going on, and I'm going to have to cut short what I was going to say, unusually, because there isn't the time to say it all. But there was a very poignant sentence by one of the people being bombed out of his home. He said, "There is no law to protect us. There is no law to protect us." Now, as a lawyer sitting there watching it, once again, one gets exercised, one gets upset, one gets angry, yes. And the moment that you aren't in that field, then you're not a human being. So yes, I'm angry. I'm angry because the real kernel of all this, which you've been listening to now for 2 days, and if you didn't know before you came, I'm sure you do by now, we all know what the problem is. We all know what the violations are. The Russell Tribunal has been identifying those in the last 3 hearings. And both the reports are available, and I suggest that they are read. Because we've had findings in relation to the violations, and there are a myriad of them. And they cover the violations. They are covered by an international framework of law that's there already. There is an economic crisis, which is affecting every corner of the world. There is a debacle that is just an inch or so away. So one has to remember that the bases of power are being threatened economically as we speak. That's the first point. Second point, people throughout the world are recognizing that this opportunity to, as it were, retake the streets is happening, which is why we are in a strong position to do exactly the same. You've seen it in various countries where regimes have fallen. But somebody down here had a banner on a computer screen here. The Occupy movement is the other one which has demonstrated very clearly the power of people collectively standing in solidarity. And that's really why we're here, is the solidarity of the legal framework that we've got. And I finish on this note because I know Angela wants to say something as well, briefly. And the reason why I'm exercised about the term apartheid, which has a definition which is not locked into South Africa. The reason I'm anxious about this is, after the last hearing, we made a recommendation that a UN body consider this term. John Dugard wrote a very informed paper on the back of what we did in South Africa. And I did the oral argument in front of an 18-delegate committee in Geneva, along with a number of other NGOs that are here today. For the first time, it's been referred to, first time, it's taken all this time, just to get a UN body to embrace that term in relation to Israel. It's the one term they don't wish to to acknowledge is the one term they've denied year after year after year. Having made that achievement, which you can read about, we have now to progress that. It's all staged, of course, but it's to get that term acknowledged by the United Nations, and of course we go to the United Nations tomorrow. So my anxiety after seeing the film and before seeing the film is, it's action now. We need plans for the future. I'm not saying one shouldn't consider other terms, but at the moment, we have enough on our plate to be going on with. Angela.
Well, first of all, it's really an honor to be able to co-chair this last session of the Russell Tribunal that is entitled Ways Forward. And I want to emphasize that the formulation is in the plural, Ways Forward. But we have now reached the point where we have to talk about strategies for resistance. And in this context, I would like to ask Phyllis Bennis, who is going to address us on U.S. civil society and international NGOs, to come forward.
This is ultimately about what we do with what we learn and what we say and what we take away from here, as is the case with all of international law. When we look at the combination of United States and UN power, we are reminded of the impact of the history, the legacy of U.S. domination of the United Nations that so often has rebuffed requests, demands by the United Nations itself. But we have another model. You know, when we look at the history of the United States, we see the history, the legacy of genocide, of slavery, of disempowerment. But parallel to that, we see another history. The history that the great historian Howard Zinn taught us in The People's History of the United States, that there is a people's history, a history of resistance, right from the beginning. So just as we see a history of UN domination of the United Nations, we see another history of civil society, social movements, joining with governments that for their own opportunist reasons are doing the right thing on the rare occasion, forcing the UN to do the right thing and do what its charter says, stand against the scourge of war, stand against empire. Remember, the UN Charter doesn't begin with the words, we the governments of the 50 most powerful white nations in the world, as the UN was founded. It begins, we the peoples. In 2010, when we heard that there was a lot of pressure from the United States against Israel. Now, in fact, there was no pressure on settlements, as we know. But we were being told there was a lot of pressure. Obama is throwing Israel under the bus. Oh my God, what are we going to do? Lots of pressure. There was a poll asking people their view of Israeli settlements. And choice number one said, Israelis are building settlements in the occupied territories for security reasons, and they have the right to build wherever they want. Sentence number two, Israelis are building settlements on expropriated Palestinian land. They should be torn down and the land returned to its original owners. Now, that happens to be accurate, but it's a very provocative way of describing it. 63% of registered Democrats chose sentence number two. That's huge. We don't acknowledge those victories. They have happened because there is a movement demanding an end to the $4.1 billion of U.S. military aid to Israel, imposing BDS requirements. What does that mean in the context of the United States? Well, it means boycotting individual actions, boycotting goods that either support Israeli occupation in the occupied territories or that support the Israeli militarization overall. Lots of different definitions. It means institutions in the United States facing divestment claims when their money is being used, the profits of that money is being used to support occupation and apartheid. And where are we seeing this? The churches. The churches are way out in front of the left and the students and all the rest of us right now. And we've heard a lot about the veto. We heard how 75% of the US vetoes cast in the last, I think it's 20 years, I recommend people to see my colleague David Wildman's incredible article on the veto. I think it's something like 75% of all US vetoes of the last 20 years have been cast to defend apartheid, either in South Africa or Namibia or Israel. So the question becomes, what do we do to reclaim the United Nations? The BDS campaign as a global campaign has played that role of uniting movements across the world, recognizing that while conditions are different in every country and therefore targets are different in every country, some countries are going to focus on sanctions, some on boycotts, some on divestment, some on goods produced only in the occupied territories, others on goods produced anywhere in Israel. Many definitions. It's a broad tent movement, and it has succeeded and is succeeding at bringing together people around the world to say, we take a lesson from the particular anti-apartheid movement that focused on South African apartheid. Israeli apartheid is different, but they are both in violation of the international covenant against the crime of apartheid. We have to use the United Nations to coordinate our civil society activism. The International Coordinating Network on Palestine, which is made up of several hundred organizations from all over the world, accredited to the Division for Palestinian Rights, which is the secretariat arm of the General Assembly Committee that has the best name in all of the UN. See if you can stick with me on this one. The Committee for the Exercise of the Inalienable Rights of the Palestinian People. The CIRP. That important committee, the name, the importance of it belied by my making fun of the name, is a very important committee, which doesn't get a whole lot of attention, but it is to that committee that organizations can be accredited, and we can use that accreditation to bring together organizations around the world who are doing their work in support of Palestinian rights in the context of international law and human rights. Our job as civil society is to pick up the slack when the United Nations fails to do the job it is mandated to do because the United States government refuses to allow it to do what it is mandated to do. That's our job. That's the job of civil society. That was the reason that the largest of the United States mobilizations on February 15th, 2003, and there were 250 some odd demonstrations across this country, but by far the largest was at the foot of the United Nations. Because we were saying to the United Nations the same thing that people around the world were saying. The world says no to war. Well, now the world is saying no to Israeli occupation and apartheid. And some of us are saying it in the streets, and some of us are saying it in the halls of Congress, and some of us are saying it in corporate boardrooms, and some more of us are saying it outside those corporate board meetings. And all of that work is coming together to create the kind of mass movement that is the only strategic answer to those failures of US-led diplomacy, of US domination of the United Nations. We need to reclaim the United Nations. We need to remember Bishop Tutu's words that we are reclaiming the United Nations in the name of those who stand for human rights, for justice, for Palestinians, and for everyone else. Thank you.
Miriam was the team leader of all this team, having done a so good job.
Not only do I feel overloaded with dignity and pleasure through this bunch of flowers, but I will just, to end this session, give you a little Shakespeare sonnet. Let us try whether it comes out well. It's all about love, and we need love to make progress in human rights. It goes like this. Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediment. Love is not love which alters when it alteration finds or bends with the remover to remove. Oh no, it is an ever fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. It is a star to every wandering bark whose worth unknown, although its height be taken. Love's not time's fool, though rosy lips and cheeks within its bending sickle's compass come. Love alters not with its brief hours and weeks, but bears it out even to the edge of doom. If this be error, and upon me proved, I never writ, nor no man ever loved.
And finally, a flower for Pierre.